Good morning, everyone. And the whole idea of this session was to understand how the faculty, how they are reading the MR. It's their approach. And I always believe that everyone has a different, slightly different perspective, a slightly different way of reading things, and we all learn from each other. So let's begin with how I read shoulder MR. And I think it's very important to know that it's not enough to know the right answers. You also need to ask the right questions. When it comes to imaging, I think what this means is you need to know what exactly is the orthopedician looking for. That's very important. Because only when you know what are the right questions, will you be able to give the right answers. And that's what the whole purpose of imaging is, to be able to help in the patient management. So let's begin with the first question. How do we do the MR? We use a surface coil like this. So it should be a dedicated coil. It could be a rigid coil like this, which is designed for the shape of the shoulder. Advantage, the respiratory movement artifacts are transmitted less. Disadvantage, you can only use it for shoulder and not for anything else. So many people tend to use other coils like flex coils, which can be multi-purpose and can be used for other coils. That's fine, but it should be a dedicated coil. Don't try doing it on a routine body coil. The images would not be of good resolution and quality. It's important to scan the patient in neutral position. That is, with the thumb kept in neutral position, or it could be externally rotated a bit. But you do not want it internally rotated. This is because the anterior inferior structures get bunched up, and that becomes, it becomes difficult to see the anterior inferior structures. There are some people who do arthrograms. In our practice, we do not do any arthrograms since more than a decade. And that's because we are able to obtain very high resolution images. 3TS is better showing the labrum and cartilage, but even with 1.5 Tesla, which we report for a large number of centers, which is includes both 3 and 1.5 Tesla, if you get good resolution, you can get good images. It's very important to keep the field of view as less as possible to cover the shoulder. You cannot keep a large field of view and then zoom the image trying to get the resolution. The spatial resolution is lost. We do not do arthrograms, like I said, but the sequences that we obtain, again, these can be a little different based on everyone's preference. When we are looking for internal derangement, we do not do a T1, but then our technologists are trained enough that if they see anything, this, I'm talking only of internal derangement. I'm not talking of tumor or infection or other marrow pathologies. Because then, yes, T1 would be an integral part of the scan. And if your technologist is not trained enough to identify something needed and add a T1, you can always keep an additional corneal T1 as a part of this. We begin with the axial PD. So this is the resolution again. Keep the field of view less, slice thickness as less as possible, and 0 millimeter gap, and you can get good images. We follow it by corneal Faxat T2. It's important that you have one Faxat T2 and not proton density Faxat, because PD Faxat and T2 Faxat are different. To look for tendon tears, to look for marrow pathologies, a T2 Faxat is what is essential. Stir is not preferable in shoulder because the resolution is a bit poor, it's more grainy image. So a Faxat T2 with adequate homogeneous fat suppression is required. Next, we do a coronal PD sequence. Again, high resolution. Follow this with the SAG PD. So we take three plain high resolution PD. High resolution means low field of view, thin sections, either 0 or 1 millimeter gap, not more than that. So not more than 3 millimeter thickness and not more than 1 millimeter gap. And the last sequence we obtain is something we call the labral sequence, which is somewhere between proton density and T1 weighted image with respect to its parameters. This we take 2 millimeter with 0 millimeter gap and cover only the labrum. So these are the five sequences that we do. Anything looks abnormal with the marrow, anything different, coronal T1 is added. If it's a tumor or an infection, the protocol is different with T1 and T2-rated images. Now, it's important to get the planning right. Ideally, we look at the supraspinatus muscle. We can see here, this is the supraspinatus muscle. And you can see that the scan should be planned coronal parallel to it, to the tendon. This is muscle and this is the tendon. So this tendon axis is what you take to plan coronal and sagittal images. So they are oblique coronal and sagittal. If you cannot identify the tendon, you can take the glenohumeral joint line and take it parallel and perpendicular to it. We make sure that the sagittal images are parallel to the inferior portion of the glenoid because we want to assess for glenoid bone loss.